and the sister, unpicking the mystery of her brother's disappearance.
I miss Richard terribly. You don't want to give up on your missing loved one. You want to find them. You want the whole world to do everything they can to look for them. And that's why I carry on.
These are stories of heartache and hope, of learning to live with a loss that's open-ended. That limbo between grief and hope can sometimes last for decades, and it's cast a long shadow over Wales's biggest band. To fans, he was Richie, the colourful figurehead of the Manic Street Preachers. Stylish, provocative, dramatic. But to his family, he was simply Richard.
He wasn't just a public persona. He was a member of our family and had friends and relationships and ultimately for me, a brother. He was 2 years older than me and he was always there for me when I was in school. If I was ever struggling with my homework, he would help me because he was always brighter than me. And that went right through, really, until the last time I saw him. We always had a good relationship. And, you know, I miss him terribly.
Richard disappeared on the 1st of February 1995. 2 weeks later, his car was found abandoned near the old Severn Bridge. He was 27. This is one of the final photographs of Richard, taken shortly before he went missing. He'd always spoken openly about his mental health problems, his depression and anxiety. But that's only half the story.
There's this thing that people call the cult of Richie that's built up over the last few decades and is this portrayal of him as this kind of ghoulish, oddball, self-harming everywhere. And it's so not the picture of him, but it's such a powerful narrative that's built up that when you try and say to people that's really not the case, it's people just stare at you as if, what are you talking about? Richard, like, really excelled in art. Even from when he was in school, he won some national art competitions. And it's just maybe something that a lot of people, really didn't know about him. So it's interesting looking at all this old stuff that we've pulled out. This probably is one of the last ones. It's just a mixture of things. This piece says, I can't imagine the world without me. And yet, ironically, he's not here now. He's not in our world anyway. He could be somewhere else. But it was just, you could see, he was still having lots of creative ideas that he was wanting to put down right to the end, really. As families of missing people, all you're left with is your imagination about where they are, and that can be your best friend and your worst nightmare as well. It can take you to hopeful places, but places of real darkness. My dad died 5 years ago, and it was really difficult because it hit home to me that he died never knowing. Because my dad was terminally ill, he knew he was going to die, so he even expressed to me once that he was so sorrowful that he knew he was going to die without him knowing. And it's just such an enormous thing to have to face. I like to think that one day we will know, and I haven't lost hope in knowing either way where he is, and I hold on to that.
The disappearance of a loved one can leave families in an emotional vacuum. Rachel Edwards finds solace here, the park in Blackwood where she would come with her brother Richard when they were younger, before he found fame in the Manic Street Preachers.
It's remarkably unchanged in terms of how it looks since that time, and that's why it's so nice, because so much has changed since he's gone missing. And when you haven't got any anchor or any place to remember someone by, no certain marking or remembrance, then coming somewhere where you recall happy times is wonderful, because you can just grasp that memory back and kind of keep it alive in your memory, and in turn keep them alive, I suppose. So it's been really great to come up here again today and remember happy times.
But some landmarks have a more somber significance. 2 weeks after Richard disappeared, his car was found abandoned near the old Severn Bridge. And this crossing plays another part in his story. For the last 23 years, Rachel has made appeals for information based on her brother's last known movements on the day he went missing. That he'd checked out of a London hotel at 7 a.m. and driven across the bridge to Cardiff later that afternoon. But she now has a new theory about what might have happened that day.
We were told that Richard crossed the bridge at 2:55 p.m. and we have the toll booth receipt that says 2:55. So we were led to believe there was an 8-hour window between his time of departing the hotel to crossing the bridge on that same day. But it's since come to light by tracking down the person who made the machines and making inquiries, that was a 24-hour clock. It always was. So that meant 2:55 was 2:55 a.m. So we were appealing to people to have seen him at certain times that day, when actually those times are meaningless now. We're hoping it'll establish a new line of inquiry, because this is vital information that changes everything and turns it all on its head. And needs to be looked at again.
Rachel will never stop searching for her brother. And that determination, in the swirl of sorrow, is what drives these families forward. They're some of the thousands of people across the country who are living in limbo. Their message is a simple one. At any time, a loved one can disappear without trace. The police have kept these cases open. And where there's heartache, there's also hope.
It's harder not to do anything. It's best to just get out there and keep actively searching, because you don't want to give up on your missing loved one. You want to find them. You want the whole world to do everything they can to look for them. And that's why I carry on.